As the last section for this lecture, I wanted to discuss the RTOS, or the real-time operating system. So let's go back to the initial question that we kind of asked when we introduced this lecture. Do we need an operating system for embedded systems? And the answer is that we don't really always need it. So for example, we can multitask several programs using the cyclic executive approach. So we have a loop here that does a bunch of parts of different tasks and it ends loop. We saw it here in this kind of diagram. It says there's some sort of entry point, does some sort of setup, then it runs the first task, then the second task, then the third task. One of them maybe reads from sensors, does calculations and displays something, and has this infinite loop that keeps on going back and doing the same thing over and over again. We call that a bare metal super loop. So it's running without an operating system on a bare metal system, and we can call that thing a super loop. So that's very simple to implement. It has low overhead, and it's very predictable how it's going to work. The problem with it is that it can't handle sporadic events. For example, if we have some sort of interrupt that comes in the middle of a task, it's not very good at that, and it complicates things. And code must be scheduled manually. So when do we need an operating system? And the answer that we gave before already is that when we have a more complex system, something like this that has different types of peripherals or different types of tasks that it has to do. So embedded systems need an operating system for convenience, because it makes it a lot easier to program, for multitasking and for running different threads, and for real-time requirements. And this is often provided by what we call an RTOS, or a real-time operating system. So it would be something like this, where we have an entry point and setup, and then we have the different tasks that are running in their loops, but we have some sort of an operating system that's deciding which task is running. And that can also handle things such as interrupts. So it's also hardware dependent what we want to choose. So if we have different types of hardware platforms over here, so we have something, you know, like an Arduino, it would be a slower processor with a little bit of flash and a little bit of RAM on it, and then going all the way over here to a bigger, faster dual core processor with a lot more flash and a lot more RAM, we have this kind of a spectrum that would go over from something that we should be running, you know, a super loop on to program our hardware, to something that's much stronger, has a lot more power, and then we may as well run an RTOS on it to make things easier to run. So when we said RTOS, we were saying it's a real-time operating system. So what is real-time? Why are we saying real-time? Well, a general-purpose operating system, which we're going to call a GPOS in these slides, it facilitates management of resources, the CPU, the memory, peripherals, etc. It facilitates multitasking, which we call scheduling, and protection, which we often call synchronization, and it can provide things like a user interface. The general-purpose operating system can usually schedule processes based on priority, and that enables some differentiation between more critical and less critical tasks. That depends on the policies, the scheduling policies that we have inside our operating system, but we can usually have a priority-based scheduling policy if we want. But we cannot guarantee timing with standard scheduling policies. So a general purpose operating system may switch from a critical task to another operation and complete the critical task only when the opportunity arises. With real-time requirements, it means that we must finish a task within a specific time frame, and that means usually that we have a certain number of milliseconds during which we must finish that task, and that usually cannot be handled by just some general-purpose type of operating system, and this white rabbit over here is late. So what are the implications of real-time operation? In a real-time system, a process has the following requirements. The first requirement is initiation time, and that's the time at which the process goes from the waiting to the ready state. When did we actually start to handle the process or the task? And the second one is the deadline. When do we have to finish the computation? And that's a very important type of thing that doesn't happen in most types of, you know, regular general purpose operating systems. What happens if we miss a deadline? Well, there's what we call hard real time, where we have a catastrophic type of event. For example, if we miss a deadline in an automotive control system, possibly, you know, we could have a braking failure and we could run into something. So that's catastrophic, and that's a hard real-time system, and we have to really be careful in the way that we program it and develop it. On the other side of the spectrum, we could have something that's more soft real-time. We want to make some sort of a deadline, but you know, it'll just impede the quality if we miss the deadline. Such as in a telephone system, maximum we miss, you know, some word that somebody said or something like that, or get lower quality. In safety-critical systems, if we did miss that deadline, we have to take some sort of compensatory measures, you know, like approximating the data or switching to a special safety mode in order to deal with it. We can't just quit. For non-safety critical systems, the failure could be ignored. Maybe bad data will not be propagated. For example, have silence and audio stream. We can call this kind of middle area between the hard real time and the soft real time. It's often called firm real time. So knowing that we need to have real time sometimes, how do we achieve that? And the answer is pretty easy. It's based on things that we've discussed already. We'll use priority-based preemptive scheduling. So what does that mean? We're going to split and prioritize the application code. So we're going to design each task separately. That makes it easy to program. It makes it, you know, not that hard super loop type of programming, which once we add a bunch of tasks, it really becomes complex to program and time everything. We're going to give each task a priority. When we give each task a priority, we can make sure that the most important task is going to be taken care of first. Tasks are usually going to be event triggered. So we're going to wait for an event and only then do the task. And event triggering avoids polling, which is very wasteful. And the real-time operating system is always going to run the highest priority task that's available. And therefore, we can have other tasks that are lower priority, but they're not going to affect the responsiveness of high priority tasks. So the bottom line from all this is that real-time operating systems are always basically preemptive. Regular operating systems, they could be preemptive or non-preemptive, but RTOSs are always going to be preemptive. And they usually are based on some sort of a time-based interrupt. We call this a tick. So every once in a while, every millisecond or something, we're going to have an interrupt that comes from the system timer, and that's going to interrupt whatever operation there is. The running task is going to be stopped. It's going to be interrupted. That's what we call preemption. The scheduler is going to be invoked. That's the scheduler of the operating system, of the RTOS, and it's going to decide which task to run next. Should it keep on running the current task, or is there a higher priority task that's waiting, or a similar priority task, and we want to give it its turn? So how does preemptive scheduling work kind of with an example? So we could have, you know, a task that looks something like this is what they're usually going to look like. So we're going to have some task that's going to have some initialization code, and then it's going to have this, infinite loop that's going to continue forever, which is going to set up to wait for some event to occur, and then it's going to wait for the event to occur. Remember, this is going to be often event triggered, so we're going to have some sort of statement that's going to just be waiting there for an event. It's going to be put on a waiting queue and wait until something happens, and then it's going to be loaded. Once it's loaded onto the CPU, it's going to perform its operation. So this is going to, each one of these tasks is going to be given a priority, and let's see how they can run over time. So remember that we have these ticks, which are going to be something like 1 millisecond or something like that, apart from each other. And what we're going to do is each of these tasks is going to have a priority. So the highest level priority is the operating system. And then, as you can see here, the priorities keep on going up from there. So every tick, the operating system is going to be invoked. And then it's going to see that it has some low priority task waiting on the ready queue. So it's going to run it on the processor. So that's task A. It's at the lowest priority there is. The next tick comes along, the OS is going to interrupt the task. The OS is going to be invoked again. It sees that nobody else is waiting, and it's going to continue running task A until it completes. So task A is completed, and for the next tick, everything's going to be idle because there's nobody waiting on any queues. Task A has some sort of event or something. It's going to want to be run again. So at the next tick, we're going to run task A again. But at the next tick that comes in, when the operating system looks, it sees there's higher priority tasks, task B and task C, that are waiting. So then in some sort of other type of a policy, maybe round robin or something like that, it's going to choose which one of these same priority tasks it's going to schedule. And it decides to schedule task B over here. At the next tick, it's going to change over to task C. And then it's going to turn over back to task B at the next tick. However, during the next time slot of while task B is running, we have something else that comes in. We have an interrupt. So an interrupt could look something like this, and it has the highest priority of all. We're going to have some sort of code that's going to enter the interrupt service routine. It's going to do some sort of work. Then it's going to send a signal or a message to tasks that says it finished doing that work, and then it's going to leave the ISR. Often these types of ISRs are going to be the triggers for running another task that was waiting somewhere, waiting for some sort of signal like that. So the ISR ran, and this ISR should be as short as possible because it's really interfering with our real-time operation of the system. So then once the ISR is finished, we're going to go and switch back to the task that was running and finish task B over here. At the next tick, we're going to finish task C. And then once task C is finished, we can go back to the lower priority task A that was waiting to finish and complete it. So that's kind of what preemptive scheduling, preemptive priority-based scheduling could look like, with interrupts that come in and can send signals to different tasks to, you know, trigger events or something like that. So if we, again, look at general purpose operating systems versus real-time operating systems, what do we have? So on the left here, we're going to see some qualities of general purpose operating systems versus real-time operating systems here on the right. So general purpose operating systems are pretty complex, and they're made for general purpose systems. So you can have multiple applications running on a system. On the other hand, real-time operating systems should be really simple, and they're used for embedded computing. Usually, they're going to be running a single application. They may be doing many things, many different tasks, but they all have one application in mind. You're not going to be switching over to, do different things like we do on one of our desktop computers or something like that. Okay, the second thing is that the general purpose operating system we discussed is, wants to maximize the resource usage. It wants to optimize the average runtime and ensure fairness between the different processes. And really, the goals of a real-time operating system are very different. We don't really care about fairness between tasks. In fact, we want to prioritize the tasks that have higher priority. We want to ensure timing and make sure that we meet hard deadlines. So it's a really different optimization goal than the general purpose operating systems have. That's actually the main difference between the general purpose and the real-time operating system. The general purpose operating system has completely non-predictable behavior. The kernel can decide all kinds of different things. There can be interrupts that can come in and cause different things to happen. We don't know when it's actually going to schedule one thing or another. On the other hand, the real-time operating system, it again has to meet timing. So it's very predictable. We have to make sure that some certain operation is going to finish within a certain deadline that was given. General purpose operating systems can be preemptive or non-preemptive. There are different scheduling policies versus real-time operating systems. They're pretty much always going to be preemptive, and they're going to be priority-based. So there's a coarse timer resolution in general purpose operating systems like Linux. There usually will be a timer that will give a tick and so forth, but it will usually have a much longer time that we can go and handle some sort of process, something on the order of 10 milliseconds or longer, versus a fine timer resolution, which is going to be on the order of 1 millisecond or possibly even shorter for the real-time operating systems in order to meet the deadlines. We have a large and protected virtual memory in general purpose operating systems, as we discussed in a previous lecture, versus in the RTOS, we're really not going to deal with all that. We're going to have usually a small memory, and it's going to have a flat memory hierarchy. It doesn't have the time and the power of processing to go and deal with something like virtual memory. Okay, and in the bottom line is that general purpose operating systems are heavy and large, things like Windows, Linux, and Mac OS X. On the other hand, RTOSes are lightweight and small. And really, the leading probably open source real-time operating system is FreeRTOS. But you also have other ones such as VxWorks and Zephyr, which are gaining popularity as well. So discussing all of that, what are the drawbacks of using an RTOS? Why wouldn't we use it all the time? And so there's a few answers here. When we're talking about embedded systems, we really want to optimize the cost and buy the cheapest hardware we can to do what we want to do, and also use the lowest power as possible. So the RTOS itself is code, and therefore it requires more flash. That's not usually going to be a problem if we already have flash, because really it doesn't need that much to hold the RTOS. However, an RTOS does require extra RAM, and RAM is going to be something that is going to raise the cost of the chip itself. So each task is going to require to have its own stack, and the size of the task depends on the application. It also needs to be assigned a task control block, which is like what we discussed as a process control block, but we may be, using tasks. They're more like threads, I would say. And there are about 32 to 128 bytes of RAM for each one of these TCBs that we have. And we're going to have about 256 bytes for the variables. So this is all costs something that we have to take into account when we see if we can run this RTOS on our system. We have to assign task priorities, and that's not a trivial type of thing to do, because that's going to really show if we're going to actually meet our deadlines or not, or cause all kinds of other problems in running our system. And the services provided by the RTOS, they do consume CPU time, so we're going to have to always interrupt and go to our scheduler and so forth, and the overhead is typically up to 10% of the CPU cycles. And finally, there's a learning curve associated with the RTOS you select. So that's another thing that we have to take into account when we're developing our system and deciding to use an RTOS. So the final thing is, do we really need an RTOS? So I just want you to look at these questions. Do we have real-time requirements? Then we should probably use an RTOS. Do we have independent tasks, things like user interface, control loops, communications, etc.? Then probably a good idea to use an RTOS. Do we have tasks that could starve other tasks? For example, updating a graphics display, receiving an Ethernet frame, encryption, etc. If we do, and that could cause, you know, some sort of a problem, then probably we should use something like an RTOS. Do we have multiple programmers working on different parts of our project? Well, if we do, then it's much easier to develop on top of an operating system than trying to make one of these super loops. Is portability and reuse important? Well, if it is, then again, an RTOS is the way to go. And if your product needs additional middleware components, things like a TCP/IP stack, USB stack, UI, file system, Bluetooth, etc., then of course you want to have an operating system and use those components even off the shelf. And the final thing is, do you have enough RAM to support multiple tasks? Because if you don't, then you probably shouldn't go with an RTOS. So to summarize this entire lecture, we learned about the operating system, and we see this kind of a drawing I made over here of the components that we discussed in this lecture. The operating system really is the central piece of software that connects the programmer to the hardware. It's the real hardware-software interface that we have in our stack of a computer. Okay, and an operating system, it has lots of practicalities and lots of research that goes well beyond this lecture. I don't want to say that I taught you everything or even a small piece of it. But what I did show you here is some of the most important concepts and terminology in this field to get you to know about it. Some things about scheduling, about protection, about interfacing, about the kernel, about the relationship between the application and the kernel and so forth. So I hope you learned something from that. And really, I used a lot of references to learn about this stuff myself. Here are just some of them, not all of them. Some of them I showed sources along the way, but there's a lot of information out there. I hope this gave you some sort of an introduction to operating systems for, you know, kind of hardware guys to know what this is, or maybe just to brush up on some of the concepts for people who did learn about these things. So I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you next time.